today as we come to the table.
One of the first consequences I want you to note here of sin is a separation from God. Right off the bat, when they sinned, they knew that something was broken. A relationship they had been broken. And the same thing is true with us. Whenever we sin, there is a relationship that is broken with God. And Adam and Eve realized that relationship was broken. You see, this is the whole reason that Jesus came, was to restore man to God, to grab the hand of man, to grab the hand of God, and to be that gap that couldn't be breached any other way. It had now been broken due to sin. And the Bible says we're all born in sin. Because we're all born in sin, we all have that gap. And so the only way that gap can be reconnected is through Jesus Christ.
There's a couple different ways to cross a river. The easiest and most obvious is to use a bridge. But if there was no bridge you could row a canoe across, and if you didn't have a canoe, you might be able to throw a rope over to the other side. And if the stream was small enough, you might be able to just hop over with a running leap. But the river between us and God? There's only one way to reach the other side. Well, thanks for staying with us today as we come to the table. The Daily Bible Study Program of Pastor Mark Kirk of Calvary, Knoxville. You'll never cross the chasm apart from Jesus. Your longest leap will fall short, and your strongest bridge will collapse halfway across. Follow Pastor Mark's teaching today and accept Jesus as the only Savior able to bridge the divide. Now, let's join Pastor Mark in the book of Genesis, chapter 3, as he begins his message, The Consequences of Sin.
Why don't we open up our Bibles to Genesis chapter 3? Looking at verses today, chapter 3, verses 8 through 13. So why don't we read them together, and then we'll go back and look at them in more detail after that. Notice what it says. It says, "And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. And then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, 'Where are you?' And so he said, 'Well, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself.' And he said, 'Well, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you that you should not eat?' And then the man said, 'Well, the woman who you gave me to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I ate.' And the Lord God said to the woman, 'What is this you have done?' And the woman said, 'The serpent deceived me, and I ate.'" We often think that our sin has no consequences. I remember as a kid, you do something wrong, you don't really always expect to get caught, and you don't expect for, you know, there to be a consequence, something to go wrong whenever you do something. And oftentimes, we do something, and it seems that because there's no immediate consequence, we think we've gotten away with it. And yet, the Bible clearly teaches that no matter what we do, if we do wrong, if we sin, there will be a consequence. You can't avoid it. It may come later, it may come immediate. But there will be a consequence. You put your hand on the eye of the stove, there's an immediate consequence. That's not a sin, but it certainly hurts. You do other things that maybe there's a delayed reaction. You don't even know that you're going to have a problem. But the bottom line is you are going to have a problem. And secondly, we also think that our sin oftentimes doesn't affect anyone else but ourselves. But the bottom line is our sin does affect others. It affects everyone around us. And just because we can't always see it, especially immediately, we deceive ourselves in thinking that we're only hurting ourselves. No, the Bible teaches that not only do we hurt ourselves, but we hurt those around us. What are some examples of that? Well, there are some very clear ones. For example, I'm very clearly reminded that in Israel, you have the Arab-Israeli conflict going on. And where does that stem from? That stems from a decision that Abraham and Sarah made many years ago to do something the way God didn't tell them to do it. God said, "I'm going to give you a child. Wait on me." And Sarah said, "Well, you know what? I don't think God's going to do it. It's been too long. We need to go ahead and take things into our own hands." Abraham agreed with her. They have another child. And now we have the Israeli-Arab conflict in the Middle East. Truly, the entire conflict that's affecting the entire world and that the whole world has their eyes on because two people, Abraham and Sarah said, you know what? I know God said it, but we don't really have to obey it exactly as God said. Certainly the consequences won't be bad. As a matter of fact, they might be good. And now we have what's going on in the Middle East. So never be deceived in the thinking that your sin will not affect others. And never be deceived in the thinking that even the things that you say to others will not affect how their life is and their perception and the way things are the result of certain things. Recently, I heard of a man who had asked his wife and said, honey, what would you like the most for your birthday? And she said, well, I'd like to be 10 again. And so wanting to surprise her and, you know, do something special, he got up early that morning and woke her up, you know, on her birthday bright and early, and they went off to a theme park. You know, I'm taking her to a theme park. She'll love this. I'm going to treat her like a 10-year-old. This would be great. So they go to the theme park, and he put her on every single ride possible in the park. He put her on the death slide, the screaming loop, the wall of fear, you know, everything that would just, you know, just completely freak her out. And that she had to go at everything. And finally, some hours later, she staggered out of the theme park with her head reeling and her stomach upside down. And he said, oh, it's not over yet. We're going to McDonald's. Because every 10-year-old wants to go to McDonald's, right? So you're off to McDonald's, and they got the double Big Mac with the extra fries, and the strawberry shake. And, of course, by now, she's about to die. You know, she doesn't want to say anything because she doesn't want to hurt his feelings. He's doing all these special things for her birthday, and she's not quite sure why he's doing all this. I guess she doesn't really get it, you know, but he's doing everything he can. Then they run off to a theater, you know, to see a kid movie and have some burgers and popcorn and cola and some sweets and all this stuff. And at last, when they finally got home, it says that she collapsed on the bed, and her husband thinking, I've done it. Man, this was a great day for my wife. And so he goes to his wife and says, honey, what does it feel like to be 10 again? And so with one eye opened and with an exhausted groan, it said, she said, actually, I meant my dress size. So you see, the things that we say, if they're taken wrong, can really affect someone's life, even as our sin affects those around us. And so don't think that it doesn't. Now, again, remember the setting here. What is the setting? The setting was, remember, they had sinned. God said, don't eat of the tree. Satan tempted Eve. Eve took the temptation, ate of the tree. They both ate of it, and then they found themselves naked and tried to cover themselves. And that's where we take up here in verse 8. Notice what it says. It says, and they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. One of the first consequences I want you to note here of sin is a separation from God. Right off the bat, when they sinned, they knew that something was broken. A relationship they had been broken. And the same thing is true with us. Whenever we sin, there is a relationship that is broken with God. And Adam and Eve realized that relationship was broken. You see, this is the whole reason that Jesus came, was to restore man to God, to grab the hand of man, to grab the hand of God, and to be that gap that couldn't be breached any other way. It had now been broken due to sin. And the Bible says we're all born in sin. Because we're all born in sin, we all have that gap. And so the only way that gap can be reconnected is through Jesus Christ. Again, at this point, the gap had not been reconnected yet, and now sin had separated, and we're going to see that God's going to come after Adam and Eve to try to bring that restoration. But also notice, not only does it separate from God, the second consequence here is that it caused them to hide from God, to run from the Lord. And here's what sin does. Sin brings us to a place of separation, and then sin brings us to a place where we run from God. Now, maybe if you've been in that situation before where you've fallen or you've started getting involved in sin, what happens to your fellowship? Do you go to church more or do you go to church less? I think we all know the answer to that. We begin to go to church less, and we begin to hang out, you know, with other people. We begin to get away from the Christians because now there's this wall, there's this gap, and the closer we get to the Lord, we feel the conviction of our conscience, and we feel the guilt of our sin, and so we begin to run and we begin to hide. And that's exactly what Adam and Eve were doing here. They were running, and they were hiding from the Lord. But God is always faithful in those times where we're running and hiding from the Lord to come after us. He himself will begin to speak to us, and oftentimes he'll send people to come get us. You know what it's like? Maybe you're not exactly where you need to be with the Lord, and you're walking through Kroger, and super Christian that you hadn't seen for like 2 months jumps around the corner in the cape and the big S. Ha ha! Bless the Lord. Praise God. How are you, brother? Right? And you're like, the last person I wanted to see was somebody that's like this, you know, because my walk's not good right now. And this, you know, and they're always all up and praise the Lord. And this thing, you're like, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And you can't let them know, right? You can't say to them, well, things aren't good right now. I hadn't been in the Word. I hadn't been in prayer. And things aren't really. So you kind of go, yes, yes, praise the Lord, whatever, you know? And so there's this whole thing because God sends people. Don't get upset about that. Realize that God has got your number. God knows you're going to Kroger's. He sends them there and goes, you get it? How did they find me? You know? Nobody's supposed to know I'm here, and yet God sends them. But God, again, they're thinking that God can't find them. They're hiding from the Lord, and yet God knows that he's got to find them to bring them back, to restore them. And again, why are they hiding? Because they feel guilty. And you know, that's one of the things that sin does, is it makes us feel guilty because we have a conscience, and God gives us a conscience. But I want to say this. Contrary to popular belief and even teaching today in our society, there is some forms of guilt that are great. Yes, there's bad guilt. What is bad guilt? Bad guilt is when you're feeling bad about something you shouldn't feel bad about. It's pretty obvious. As a believer, you've asked God to forgive you, and yet you still feel guilty about the way you treated your wife, or the way you treated your husband, or the way you treated your kids, or what you did 10 years ago, or 5 years ago, or last month, or whatever. That's wrong. The Bible says when you confess your sin, God is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So that kind of sin, we know, or that kind of guilt is wrong. But there is a godly guilt. And it is wonderful. And although people try to put it aside, it is something that is desperately needed in our society today. And that is, when we do something wrong, we feel conviction that we've done something wrong. And it is that conviction that is supposed to drive us to God to ask forgiveness. So guilt is a good thing. If you're here today and you're feeling guilty, now determine which kind of guilt it is. If you've asked God's forgiveness and you've repented, you've got to turn it over to the Lord and let it go. But if you're sitting here today feeling guilty about something that you've not gotten right, I'm glad. Because what that's going to do is that's going to drive you to the Lord. And God's beginning to speak to your heart and say, you know what? You need to get right with me. And you need to be restored with me. And you're going to say, God, I confess my sin and ask you to forgive me of my sin and restore me to you. It's a godly guilt. It's a healthy guilt. And it's a guilt that will lead to eternal forgiveness. And so again, don't fear guilt unless it's the wrong kind. Use it as a tool to drive you to the Lord. And again, with guilt, we have two choices. We can either make, run and hide, or we can make it right. Adam and Eve here chose at this point to run and hide, again, making the wrong decision. But again, we'll see that God continues to chase them and not to let them get away with it. You know, there's an old non-biblical parable that says the Bible will keep you from sin and sin will keep you from the Bible. Well, the same thing is true about our relationship with the Lord. That is, sin will keep us from fellowship and fellowship will keep us from sin. If we're walking with the Lord, we desire more fellowship. If we're not walking with the Lord, we desire less fellowship. And so we need to recognize that and find out, Lord, why am I in the place that I'm in? And see if there's some situation that God wants to deal with in our heart. And so again, notice here it says that when God came to them, he came in the cool of the day. Literally, it's the word ruach, which is used in the Hebrew of God's spirit. So what he's saying is God came to him. God spoke to them by the Holy Spirit, beginning to say, Adam, where are you? What are you doing, Adam? What's going on? In other words, God's speaking to Adam by his spirit in that still small voice. And so Adam knew that he had sinned. God knew that he had sinned. Adam's running and hiding, but God's calling him back saying, Adam, where are you? And what's interesting about this is I don't think this was just a question of position. Let me ask you something. Did God know where Adam was? God knows all things. God knew exactly where Adam was physically, and God even knew where Adam was spiritually. But this question, when he said to Adam, Adam, where are you? It wasn't just a physical location. He was talking about in heart, in spirit. Adam, where are you? What happened to our relationship? Why did you choose to disobey? What has happened in your life that you feel you need to run from me now rather than run to me? You rather than knowing I'm a loving father, now you're hiding among the trees. Where are you, Adam? And see, God may be saying that to some of you today. You know that you're not where you need to be with the Lord. Maybe you've been dabbling in areas you don't need to dabble in. Maybe you've never given your life to the Lord at all. But God is saying to you, where are you? Again, he knows where you are physically, but he wants you to know where you are spiritually. And notice I said he wants you to know. See, God knows, but God wants us to challenge ourselves. And that's a question we need to ask ourselves. We need to say, hey, am I in the Word? Am I in prayer? Am I in regular fellowship? If I'm not, then why not? Where am I? Where am I in my walk with the Lord? Have I grown cold? Has my love run dry? And see, when we begin to probe ourselves and ask ourselves that question, then we can begin to deal with it before the Lord. And so understand God's intention here with Adam was to have Adam search his own heart, not just to ask him where he was. Adam, where are you? You tell me, Adam. I want to know what's going on because I want to restore you. And so again, you may be hearing God's voice today. Don't run from his voice and try to hide. The Lord has come to restore. He's come to heal. And so God now shows up to Adam, asks him where he is, and notice, then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, here in verse 9, and we already actually covered it for the most part, but where are you? Now, again, I don't think that when he came to him, he did like probably I would have done. You know, Adam, where are you? This garden's a mess. Get out of here right now. You know, the way we deal with our kids or whatever. You know, there's fruit everywhere. This is now, right? I believe what God said was, Adam, where are you? I think God was coming with a voice of chastisement or a voice of yelling. God had come to restore him. God knew that Adam had sinned. He knew that Adam needed to be restored. And I think that sometimes we're afraid to come back to the Lord because we're afraid we're going to get in trouble. That God's up there waiting to, you know, just knock us on the head with some divine lightning bolt. And yet the Bible says that God has compassion and mercy for those who come to him in brokenness. God gives grace. And so we need not be afraid to come to the Lord and say, you know what, Lord, I need to ask your forgiveness. I need to get right with you. I need to recognize where I am. And so where are you? And so he said, well, I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. Now, notice once he heard God's voice, he was afraid and he hid. Again, why? Because our sin is only magnified the closer we get to the Lord and we see his holiness. See, the closer the Lord got and began to speak to Adam's heart, he realized, you know what, I'm a wicked sinner. Remember in the boat where Jesus was there with Peter and he said, cast the net on the other side. And he caught all the fish and Peter realized this is supernatural. I'm in the boat with someone that is not a normal man. And at that point, Peter fell down and said, Lord, depart from me. I'm a sinner. I'm an unclean man. But the Lord said, no, you don't understand. I'm here to cleanse you. He said, I'm going to make you a fisher of men. I love you. I've come for you. Now, we see the same spirit here with Adam. The Lord had come for him. And yet there's that sense when we're close to the Lord and we begin to hear the Lord's voice, we begin to run because we're afraid. And we often feel like, you know, I'm too unholy to be next to God. Well, let me say this. We are too unholy to be next to God, but not with the blood of Jesus Christ. By the blood of the cross, now we can approach him. Now we can go near him. See, now the blemishes that we see, he washes away. Listen, the closer you get to a light, the worse it looks. Oftentimes I've heard believers that say, I'm trying to seek the Lord with all my heart, but the closer I get to him or the harder I seek him, it seems the worse I get. You ever been that way? Understand, it's not because you're getting worse. God's just showing you more of who you really are. Because you're getting closer to the light. Ladies, you'll understand this. The big mirror, right? And I don't know why, you know, they have the mirror and you want to go and you want to put the makeup on. Well, you want to be able to see where, you know, makeup needs to go, right? But then they put these big airport lights across the top, right? And you flip a big switch. They come out. Who couldn't see every blemish? I mean, you can see everything. And yet the point is so you see what's really there, so now you can deal with it. See, what God does with his word and his spirit, he comes to us and goes, the spiritual lights come on and we go, whoa, lots of blemishes. I've got some spiritual makeup I need to put on. And he says, all you need is the blood. Covers it all. Wouldn't it be great if you had like one makeup lady, just put it up, whatever, it's done. We have that in the spiritual realm. We have the one spiritual makeup that takes away every blemish, and it's simply the blood of Jesus Christ. So when you get closer to the Lord, don't panic because you see yourselves as worse. You're just seeing really more of what you really are. But realize the blood cleanses it. And it's because of that we become more humble and more broken before the Lord in the light of his holiness. Paul, here's Paul the apostle. And Paul says, I am the chief of sinners. Now, compared to us, what would Paul be like? I mean, Paul would probably be like Jesus compared to me. And yet compared to Jesus, what's Paul like? Nothing. And so the point is that the closer we get, the more we see the blemishes. Paul was very close. And so we get closer and we see those. Now Adam and Eve running and hiding. The Lord begins to come close and they begin to, you know, just to hide because they're afraid. Saying, you know what? We see our sin. We see what we look like in the spiritual mirror. And also we need to realize here that we need to have a fear of God in a reverence, but not a fear of God in what he's going to do if we come to him in brokenness. God is merciful and God is gracious. And so again, they needed to learn this. They needed to understand this. And notice also that Adam recognized he was naked. He said, I saw that I was naked, I hid myself. That is that he was exposed before God in his sin. The Bible says that we have to give an answer to him with whom we have to do. God sees all things. And so we stand before God naked, so to speak, spiritually. And in every other way, God sees everything. God knows everything. And there's nothing that we can hide from the Lord. So if you're trying to hide something or you think you can hide something, understand first, God sees it. Now the good news is God forgives it. If we simply ask. But we have to repent and we have to ask for his forgiveness. God sees all things, the Bible says. Psalm 139, 7 through 12 says this. Notice the psalmist writing. He said, where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? In other words, I can't get away from you. If I ascend into heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you're there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, well, surely darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you. Isn't it amazing to think that no matter how dark it is and how much we think no one can see us, that to the Lord, it's just like daylight? See, God sees everything. Now, this can be good news or bad news. It's bad news if you're still trying to do it and you're not going to repent. It's good news if you recognize he sees me. He's got my number. God, I'm naked before him, and I've got to stand before him and give an account one day and give an answer, so I'm going to deal with it right now. Father, forgive me and cleanse me. And that's the beauty of the cross, that we are forgiven and we are cleansed. Notice the Lord asked him, and he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded that you should not eat? Now, By Adam revealing that he knew he was naked, it revealed that his conscience was convicting him of sin, which in turn revealed that he had eaten the forbidden fruit. Now, God knew that, but God wanted Adam to admit it. You see, God brings us to a place in our life with our sin where he says, look, I know what you're doing. I see all things, but I want to bring you to a place where you see it. I want you to recognize I've sinned. I have done wrong. And again, take personal responsibility. Because again, God knew that Adam needed to realize it and confess it, because it is the first step to repentance and restoration. If we don't realize we have sin and we don't confess our sin, we can't be led to a place of restoration and repentance before the Lord. So he's challenging Adam to draw it out. He knows all this, but he wants Adam to know it and Adam to admit it. And notice what it says here in verse 12. And then the man said, well, and this is like an age-old accusation, the woman, you know, it's her fault. It's the wife you gave me, God. That's why I've got so many problems. And again, now blaming his wife. And note this, one of the consequences of falling away from God is a falling away in our relationship to our spouse. You know, our relationship to our spouse is directly related to our relationship to God. When I see people that have a real good relationship with God, I can tell you without meeting them at all, if I hear they have a good relationship, their marriage is good, at least on their part. Why? Because there's a biblical principle. If our relationship with God is good, our relationship with our spouse will be good. Now, maybe our spouse doesn't have a good relationship with God, so therefore the marriage is not strong. But we are right with our spouse, and we are right with God. And when both are right with God, there's a blessing. That's just a biblical principle. It goes that way. But I love this here. Notice his first response when confronted with sin is it's somebody else's fault. I didn't do this. It's not my fault. There must be somebody else to blame. And notice Adam blames Eve rather than taking personal responsibility. Lord, it's this woman's fault. It's my wife's fault. She's causing the problems. God says, stop it. It's your fault. You need to realize it, admit it, and confess it, and then I'll bring healing. But as long as your finger is pointing at someone else, I can't do that. Remember, kids on the playground, what happens if they're doing something wrong and the teacher comes out? Hey, what's going on here? Fingers go everywhere. Bobby, Eddie, Steve, Susie, Joe. I mean, they're just like, wasn't me, anybody but me. And when you ask your kids, you know, you go, those of you that have kids, you say, you know, you hear the lamp break, right? All right, who did it? It's amazing. None of them. None of them did. It just, they were standing there and this lamp just flew up in the air. Look out. Oh, what mom and dad going to think now? They'll think one of us did that. So we have to tell them when they come, no, that we didn't do that. It just, this man came in, he threw it, he ran, he went, whatever. It is in our nature to try to get out of it, is it not? And yet God will corner us and confront us and say, I'm not going to let you out of it. Right now, God is confronting some of you. You've been trying to get out of it. You think that you're okay, you're not doing that bad, maybe your sin's not that big, maybe you, God's been convicting you that you need to come to him for the first time, but you're thinking, well, you know what, I'll go to church with you, but I'm not really going to listen. I'm still going to get out of it. God's going to continue to corner you. Why? Because he loves you. He sees you and you're naked before him. He's going to chase you down so that he might clothe you in his robes of righteousness through his son, Jesus Christ, who died for you on the cross. And so that's exactly what the Lord's doing here. You know, and again, Adam blaming somebody else. That's true that she offered him the fruit, but he made his own choice to eat it. And see, here's the biblical principle. Yes, God is going to deal with those who tempt us. God will deal with them. The Bible says that. But the bottom line comes down to what choice we make. It's our personal choice that we will be held accountable for before God.
Thanks for joining us as we come to the table of God's Word with Pastor Mark Kirk. In this series, Pastor Mark is teaching from the book of Genesis. Genesis is a book that covers genealogy, world history, and God's promises. It was written by Moses to those who perhaps needed the reminder of how God came through for his people, no matter what. Do you need this reminder today? We're so glad you decided to join us for this series. There's nothing greater than spending time together at the feet of our Lord. Come to the Table is a radio outreach ministry of Calvary, Knoxville. If you're in the Knoxville, Tennessee area, we'd love to see you in person. We have services on Saturday at 6 p.m., Sunday at 9:30 and 11:15 a.m., and Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. If you're interested, go to thewaymedia.net and scroll to the bottom of the page. You'll notice a link to Calvary Knoxville. If you can't make it in person, you can find all sorts of messages available at thewaymedia.net. Or you can download these messages too on the Way Media app. Find it at your Apple App Store or Google Play Store. We're about out of time for today's edition, but we want to hear from you. Would you give us a call and let us know what you've been learning from Genesis? Our number is 865-609-1385. Once more, that's 865-609-1385. Pastor Mark has more to share with us as we go verse by verse through this book of beginnings. Keep reading, so you'll be ready to dig through Genesis the next time we come to the table. Come to the Table is a radio outreach ministry of Calvary, Knoxville.